So Father, we just bless you this morning because we need you now. And we just bless you that we have you now. We just thank you that you are God and that you're a covenant-keeping God. We just thank you that you're the God who's there and who is the now God in Israel this morning. Lord, we just bless you. We think about our brothers and sisters there this morning who are doing right now what we're doing, who are gathering around your table to remember who you are and what you have said. And so, Father, as we do this morning, we gather with them. We gather with our brothers and sisters all over this world this morning, Lord. We gather to come to you, to bless you, and to thank you for this table.
You've heard your children then, you hear your children now. You are the same God, you are the same.
You're the God of Jacob this morning.
You answered prayers back then, you will answer.
You're our God this
you
morning.
You are the same God, you are the same God. You are providing them.
That's right.
You
split
are
the Red
providing
sea.
Now. You are the same God. You are the same God.
Yes.
You moved in
You're
power
the yes,
then. God move in power now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You are a healer then. God, you're a healer now. You are the same.
A little bit this morning from where Pastor James left off last week. So interesting, you know. So I walk out of the building last week after James, if some of you that may not have been there, but Pastor was talking about the different views of the end times. And interesting, right? Like a few things I had forgotten about. But I walked out, and John, I see John, and John says, we talked a minute, and John says, well, you know, Mom, you're pre-wrath. And I said, what? And he said, yeah, no, you're pre-wrath. And that's a way of looking at the end times. In other words, I said, I am? He said, oh, no, you are. You're definitely pre-wrath. Pre-wrath means, John, maybe you want to get up and explain it. I don't know. Pre-wrath means that you believe that the church will be around for some tribulation, but when it comes to the period of wrath, where God pours out his wrath, the church is removed. And I think that that's closest to what I believe. I don't know that I believe the church is not going to be around for any of the tribulation. I think we probably will. Although I'm ready to go tonight. My suitcase is always right by the door. Right at night when I go to bed, suitcase is always packed. I'm ready to go at any time, but I do think that he's probably right. I am pre-wrath, which was nice for you to tell me, John, because I had no idea. Anyway, so as we were talking about, and as James has started to look at this book, the Revelation, I think we're gonna look at some ways of looking at it this morning that I honestly have to tell you have taken me 50 years to understand, and I mean that with everything that's in me. And if the Holy Spirit can relate to you some of the glimpses that I feel like he's been showing me about it, honestly, it's changing my life, and it should change the church, which should change the church. So I just pray for those that are hungry in this room that you will reach out and take from the Holy Spirit what he wants to give this morning. I believe it with all that's in me that he is here to do that this morning. So as we look at the book of the Revelation, you know, I guess I'm videoed, right? This is so difficult because I spent a lot of years not being videoed, and I took my shoes off all the time, and sorry out there, but I'm taking my shoes off. Funny. Well, it's interesting, saints, because as we look at the Revelation and as James has been telling us, you know, it's not a book about, first, it's not a book about all of the things that are going to, the tribulation and all that's going to happen. It is not. The book starts out by saying this is a revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it starts out with this amazing vision that John has of what? Of him. The ascended, the glorified, awesome, majestic Lord Jesus who vanquished death, and now he is coming to his friend and disciple in his ascended and glorified position. Actually, he's not Jesus of Nazareth anymore. He's the Christ. He's the Christ. That body was left behind. He's in a new body now. His people, in his people. That revelation, that encounter that John had, I'll never forget Jack Hayford saying years ago, the church today, and this is 20 years ago maybe, needs their same revelation of seeing Christ today in his ascended and his glorified position, his majesty, his position, and his authority. And that's what the Father gave his children there in that first century that were suffering and persecuted and all they were going through. What did he do? He showed them the ascended, glorified Lord Jesus, that he is sovereign and supreme over all. And brothers and sisters, that's what you need, and that's what I need in this hour, and that's what our brothers and sisters in Israel need today. And as I was going this way and preparing for this, I came across this video that is by John Piper. It's a short video, but I thought there couldn't be anything better that I can do to start this morning than by showing you this video. And I thank Michael Dixon, who was called out enlisted. Oh, he enlisted. He enlisted. He enlisted. So Michael's going to put that on for us this morning. Just relax. Take a deep breath. And let the Holy Spirit move over your heart as you watch it. Thank you to Rachel Vocal for putting it together yesterday. Because I'm so easy to work with. It's okay. It's okay. God's got it. That's right. There you go, Michael. That's it.
Of Christ, the supremacy of his deity, equal with God the Father in all of his attributes, the radiance of his glory, and the exact image of his nature. The supremacy of his eternality that makes the mind want to explode with the imponderable thought that Jesus Christ never had a beginning. He is simply there, absolute reality with which we reckon. We must rise to the supremacy of his eternality. While all the universe, including this building and your body and this earth and all the galaxies, are fragile, contingent, like a shadow in comparison to the substance of Jesus Christ. We must know the supremacy of his never-changing constancy. Oh, to have virtues that never change, a character whose commitment is constant, yesterday, today, and forever. Let us know the supremacy of his constancy. And let us know the supremacy of his knowledge that makes the Library of Congress look like a matchbox and makes all the information on the internet look like a 1940s farmer's almanac. And makes all of quantum physics and everything that Stephen Hawking has ever dreamed look like a first grade reader. We must know the supremacy of the knowledge of our Lord. We must know the supremacy of his wisdom that has never been perplexed by any problem whatsoever, nor can he be counseled by any person or any being in the universe. We must know the supremacy of his authority. All authority is mine in heaven and on earth and under the earth. No change. All authority. Changing times and seasons, removing kings, setting up kings, doing according to his will in the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. No one can stay his hand or say to him, "What have you done?" We must know the supremacy of his providence, without which not a single bird in the extended reaches of the Amazon forest has ever fallen off of any limb, and without which not one hair turns white or black. We must know the providence of Jesus. We must know the supremacy of his word, which upholds the universe by the word of his power. All the galaxies, molecules, atoms, and subatomic reality nobody has yet dreamed of down there where no one has yet looked. We must know the supremacy of his power to walk on water and cleanse lepers and heal the lame and open the eyes of the blind and open the ears of the deaf and cause storms to cease, and with two words to raise the dead, "Lazarus, come forth," or one word to raise the dead, "In your blood I said to you, live." We must know the supremacy of his power. We must know the supremacy of his purity. He never sinned. He never sinned. He never had one millisecond of a bad attitude or a sinful lust. We must know the supremacy of his trustworthiness. He never breaks a promise. He always keeps his word, absolutely without fail. We must know the supremacy of his justice. He will render all accounts settled in the end, in the universe, either on the cross or in hell. No injustice will remain when Christ is finished with his supreme justice. We must know the supremacy of his patience. He has endured you and me for decades. He has endured this city and brings the sun. Can you imagine why the sun rose on this city this morning, this wicked city, this world so full of us-type sinners, and he makes paradise rise in the sky in Minneapolis? What kind of patience are we dealing with here? We must know the supremacy of His servant-like sovereign obedience, kept every one of His Father's commands absolutely, and in the end embraced the cross with total willingness. We must know the supremacy of His meekness and lowliness and tenderness. He will not break a bruised reed or quench a smoldering flax. We must know the supremacy of His wrath. One day it will explode on this world from heaven, such that all who have rejected Him will call for rocks to crush their brain, lest they have to face the wrath of the Lamb. We must know this. When I look at the beheadings and I hear someone ask, "Where is your Supreme Christ?" my answer is really easy. He is in heaven, storing up almighty wrath in fury to pour out on all those who commit such sins. That's where He is. And you better get right with Him and repent, or you will all likewise perish. It's not a hard question to answer biblically. We must know the supremacy of His grace, which gives to the spiritually dead rebels like us life, wakens faith in hell-bound haters of God, justifies the ungodly with His own righteousness. We must know the supremacy of His love, which dies for us while we are yet sinners, and gives to the absolutely undeserving the ability for ever-increasing joy in making much of Him. We must know the supremacy of His gladness. In the fellowship of the Trinity, infinite power, infinite energy, infinite joy rising, spilling over in the creation of a universe, and becoming for you one day an inheritance for every struggling saint. We must know this is what we were made for. Press on to know the Lord. We are made to know Christ. We're not made to do little diddly things. We're made to know this massive Christ. This world is little two-second slice, and then with Him or not, forever. It's what we are created to know and do and be about. And when we know Him in those ways, we have begun to know the outskirts of His supremacy. For time would fail to speak of His supreme severity and invincibility and dignity and simplicity and complexity and resoluteness and calmness and depth and courage. If there's anything admirable, if there is anything worthy of praise in all the universe, it is summed up in Jesus Christ. He is always infinitely admirable in everything and over everything supreme. Over all galaxies and endless reaches of space, over the earth, from the top of Mount Everest, 29,000 feet up, to the bottom of the Pacific Ocean, 36,000 feet down in the Mariana Trench in the Pacific Rim. He is sovereign and supreme over all plants and animals, from the peaceful blue whale to the microscopic killer viruses. He is supreme over all weather and all movements of the earth, hurricanes, tornadoes, monsoons, earthquakes, avalanches, floods, snow, rain, sleet. He is supreme over all chemical processes that heal or destroy cancer, AIDS, malaria, flu, and all the amazing grace of antibiotics and 1,000 healing drugs that we do not deserve. He is supreme over all countries and governments and armies. He's supreme over Al-Qaeda and the terrorists and the kidnappings and the suicide bombings and the beheadings. He is supreme over Bin Laden and al-Zarqawi. He is supreme over all nuclear threats from Iran and Russia and North Korea. He is supreme over politics and elections and debates on Thursday. He's supreme over media and news and entertainment and sports and leisure. He's supreme over all education in universities, no matter what they teach. And he's supreme over all scholarship and science and research. He's supreme over all business and finance and industry and manufacturing and transportation. And he's supreme over the internet and all informational systems. As Abraham Kuyper famously said, there is not one square inch on planet Earth over which the risen Christ does not say, mine, and I rule it. I am supreme over. We must know this Christ. And though it may not seem to you as though he holds such supreme rule now, it is but a matter of very short time until he comes with the glory of his Father and all his angels in flaming fire, giving relief to those who trust him and absolutely destroying to the uttermost in everlasting conscious torment those who have rejected him, saying, where is your God? Oh, help us, Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But now, the book of Hebrews says, but now we see Jesus. Now we see, we don't see all things subject to him right now. But now we see Jesus, and now we see Jesus at his table with us, his children. That he's not only the lion, but he was the lamb that laid his life down for you and for me. So, Father, we pray today, not just for us in this room, and not just for Israel and our brothers and sisters there. We pray for the body of Christ, your children all over this globe, that our eyes would be opened and we would see you as you really are today. Lord, Father, we need a vision of our ascended Lord. We are so tired of hearing him spoken about the way he is on our news channels and our comics and our movies, where his name is just a curse that said every other word. We're so vexed as we live in this world. Father, we're so vexed by the world and its sin and death. And it's such a joy to come to this table this morning, to know that we are your children and that we will never face your wrath, and that you have taken us into yourself, and that you've set this table before us, Lord, and that you long for us to know you. You long for us to know the plan that you have for all generations, and we're asking you, Holy Spirit, this morning, that you would start to open our eyes and free us from the fog that we live in here on this planet now at this age. You'll free us from the fog that makes you so small, that makes you so little, that even us, your children, can be offended at you and wonder what you're doing. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us, because we're so blind unless you open our eyes. You are coming. You showed us in your book that you're coming as a judge. one day. And so we bow our head to you, we bow our knees, and we honor you this morning. Because you're not only the Savior, you are the King. And this morning we come to you as King this morning. That you're not only full of grace for us, you also have a government. And you're the King of that government. And that government is coming onto this earth. And we believe shortly that is going to happen. So, Father, I just pray for all of us this morning that you will help us to be free this morning of all the things that were so important to us when we walked through those doors. All the things that we think are catastrophes and things that we're just living to change and see things change. And Lord, we're asking you to give us eyes to see you this morning, to see what you have done for us this morning. Change us, Lord. We can't change ourselves. Change us. Change us, Lord. And so, Lord Jesus, we come and we take your body and your blood now. We lift up the cup. And we thank you for your, because of your blood, our sins are forgiven, and we are now in your sight as holy and blameless. We sang it this morning, Lord. We belong to you. We're your people. We're your inheritance. We thank you for your blood that covers our sin this morning, Lord. But we also thank you, Lord, for your body. For your body that set us free from all the powers of darkness. That not only in that cross did you take my sins, but you took me and you set me free forever. You cut the strings of Satan in our lives. And now we are your free children. So Lord, with great joy and with honor to you, we partake right now of your body and your blood as your people, as your children this morning. Let's do that this morning, saints. We thank you. Thank you for your promises. We thank you for healing this morning that's ours. We thank you for freedom that's ours, Lord. We thank you for salvation that's ours this morning, Lord. Father, we bless you. Take it together. Knowing, Lord, that we're not just individuals, we're a people. We're brothers and sisters in this room. We're your people. We thank you, Lord. And we bless you and we praise you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. What did you think of that? Was that powerful? It was great, wasn't it? I need you to do a favor for me, please. So, you know, I'm really like a dinosaur when it comes to the what do we call them? PowerPoints? What did we used to call them in the old days? Huh? Overheads, yeah. Overheads and things like that. So James is always telling me that I need to use the PowerPoints. So when you see him, the next time you see him, do me a favor. Got a little furniture moving going on here. When you see him, just say to him, Pastor James, you missed the best PowerPoints Pastor Linda had on Sunday. If he says, what? Just say, oh, no, they were the best. They were such good PowerPoints. All right, there you go. There you go. I guess you're wondering what this is, right? Let's move this. We'll get to this in a minute. Somebody's going to have to do this for me, too. I don't even know how to do it. How do I do this? Click this guy. I'm going to ask you to click for me, Mike, okay? Yeah, I'm going to ask you to do it. So we're not going to get there quite yet. Actually, yeah, we're all going to get there quite now. Yep. So You've heard the expression, something that's hidden in plain sight. You know, it's like you, if you're like me, running through the house, murmuring because you can't find your glasses, but they're on you. Has it ever happened to you? Yeah. So I hope we can see this, but you know, probably not as well. But talking about seeing things in plain sight. This is the emblem for the Pittsburgh Zoo. Is there anything you see with the tree? It's probably a little hard to see it. Maybe we can. Do you see anything in there that you do? What do you see? You people are good. You see the face of the lion and the, what's the other one? Yeah, there you go. Hidden in plain sight. Looks like just birds, but if you look closely. Let's do the next one, Mike. Now this one, I may be a little harder. Now, tell me what you see there. Oh, for the love of Pete. You guys all knew this? 31 flavors? Wow, I guess it's just me, huh? All right. Did anybody not know, like me, that didn't know that hidden in plain sight is 31 flavors? Yeah. Yep. Well, the reason I'm showing us that this morning is because I am so deeply convinced, so thoroughly convinced, that maybe the greatest truth in the Bible, or certainly some of the greatest truths, the greatest foundation of truths, are in the Bible and hidden in plain sight. I believe that there are things that God is opening our eyes to see at this hour, and will be, because those saints in Israel and the saints in this room and in America, I believe we're going to have to understand and going to have to know beyond a shadow of a doubt. We are going to have revelation that we have not had before. I believe that with everything that's in me. And I believe it's exciting. I believe it's mind-blowing. And I want to tell you, I'm also very aware of powers in the room. It's like trying to even get through powers. Do you understand? You know what, Michael? I know now this is, I'm really stretching you. But I think it's 3 and 4 where there's a definition of, no, one more. Let's go one more. No, next one. There we go. This is a definition for the word world. And it is the word, we use that word world in Romans 12:1, be not conformed to the world, right? So what, this is the Greek, this is Kenneth Wiest's translation that has lived with me for so many decades. I have come back to this definition so many times. And this is what Kenneth Wiest said, this is how he transcribes how he interprets and what's the word? Translates the Greek word world. World, all that floating mass of thoughts, opinions, maxims, speculations, hopes, impulses, aims, aspirations, at any time current in the world, which it may be impossible to seize and accurately define, but which constitute a most real and effective power, being the moral or immoral atmosphere which at every moment of our lives we inhale, again inevitably to exhale. All this is included in the age, which is the subtle informing spirit of the cosmos, or world of men who are living alienated and apart from God. Now, you know what that tells us? It tells us that the world that we live in, and the way that that word is used in Romans, in that Romans passage, and many other places in the Word of God, the world, when Jesus says, love not the world, that we're crucified to the world, it's talking about a system that has been created, a system that is opposed to kingdom of God. It's a different kingdom. And it's a system that has been put together. Actually, it started in from Babel. That's where we get the word Babylon. That's where the final confrontation is going to be. It's going to be Babylon. We see it in the Revelation. But what we see is that we live in a world where we're inhaling and exhaling truth, not truth, mostly lies, some truth too, but lies, just thoughts that are constantly bombarding us. It's like asking a fish, what is water? You and I live in it every single day. And what's most subtle and insidious about it is that you and I don't even know it. We don't think about it. We get dressed, we go out, we get in the car, we go to work. Who's thinking? Now listen, I don't want to get in trouble with this, but please know my heart when I say this. You know how things pop up on your Facebook thing, and you know. So this thing popped up last week, and it was, they were discussing why young women do not want to have children. And listen, I am not here to make a comment about that, and everyone has that choice, and I'm not putting people down that women that don't want children. But if you heard the reasons why these women were saying they didn't want children, I wanted to throw up. You know, you lose your figure. You know, it interferes with your career. You know, the kids are sick a lot, and you wind up getting sick too. You know, you have to, you know, and then it's all the money. They cost so much money. Well, they do cost a lot of money. John, you do, Jennifer, you do. But brothers and sisters, I thought about all of the floating mass of thoughts that are attacking our young people, telling them what to believe. And the thing is this. A lot of times you and I think we're thinking, but you're listening. Listen, that's worth the ticket this morning. If that's all you get this morning, you're going to get. But if that's it, if you got that, because I'm realizing how much I am bombarded and find myself listening. And I think it's me thinking. If we do not, as the people of God, come out of our carnal, worldly, fleshly lives and come into the supernatural life that we are called to understand these things and walk by the Spirit. You know, God's the Spirit. You can't know God unless you're in the Spirit. You can't know God unless you're born again and have your spirit enlivened. And Satan is a spirit. So that means the warfare is not what you can see. It's not what you can hear. But that warfare is constant, and you wonder why we're tired all the time, and you think, I don't know, I'm just more tired. It must be my age. It's just my age. Well, it's not just your age. We are bombarded by waves. Oh, come on, Linda. Seriously? Oh, really? Well, are there radio waves in this room? Are there viruses in the room? Why can we believe that these things exist? But as soon as you are a Christian and you talk about the spirit world, everybody, oh, come on, that's. Now, who's the one that doesn't want us to know that? And I'm saying that until we as the church start to understand the life we're called to, and the battle that we're called to. Because if you ask me, and if you listen to me, and you give me a chance to talk to you a little bit in the next coming weeks and months, I'm telling you, we've got to get out of our little natural little level, our little carnal little prayers, where we don't even understand what the basis and foundation of our prayer should emanate from. Like, now what is this here? Do me a favor, Naeem, let's push this back a little bit for me, please, so that we can get a better the pulpit back. Thank you. Thank you, Joe Pinto, Lee, Joanne. They're all my artists. They put this together for me. Now, if you were around last year, I was using carpet I was standing on. One was the old, one was the new. And I was like, well, nobody can see it. I'm standing on it. That doesn't make much sense. So I'm thinking and thinking, and this was my idea. So, Lord, I really need your help. We have got to understand something, saints. You know, the Bible and every word of the Bible is for us. Do you believe that? Every word of the Bible is for us. But you know what? Not every word in the Bible is to you. That's where the church gets in a lot of trouble. That's where the church gets legalistic. That's when we start reading things in the Old Testament and not understanding that that is not for his children. Now, I'm saying we need the Old Testament, and it is the bud for the flower, and it's all there. But everything in the Old Testament had one goal, pointed. The lamb was pointing to the lamb that was coming. The tabernacle was all about the Christ that was coming. There isn't an example. There's nothing you can see in the Old Testament that's doing anything except pointing to the one that was coming. And I want to tell you, you're going to hear me say this over and over and over again. That's what I got up and said last week after James talked about the different views of the end times. Satan doesn't care what you believe. He doesn't care what you believe. As long as you stay down on the earth with your little belief, it's in your head. You have no revelation. Whatever your beliefs are, what he cares about. Is when the resurrected life of Jesus Christ is released from a human being, because he is there. He is a child of God. And when the living, resurrected Lord Jesus lives through a person and manifests the victory that destroyed him, that he cares about. You see, we're not witnesses because we go around and give tracts to people. We're not witnesses because we're trying to talk everybody into loving Jesus. You're a witness because he lives in you, and the resurrected life, the life that went through death and came out on the other side as absolutely victorious, lives in us as his children. It's changing my life. When I'm in a struggle now, and there's a problem I have, and I feel overwhelmed, I say, no, right here, right now, I have to display what I'm here for on this earth right now is to display the fact that Satan has no rights over me, and that I will not come unto him, and he will not push me around, and I will stand in the victory of Jesus Christ. And God will get me through into victory in this situation. But if you're just listening, oh, it's terrible. Nobody loves me. My life is just so hard. It's just like, oh yeah, well, everybody else is good, but yeah, I don't know. I don't hear from God. You keep listening. That's what he wants you to do. Just keep listening. That's why the first weapon is truth. The belt of truth. You have to answer. You have to answer with the truth. Because the lies are not going to go away. And the lies are surrounding our young people. The colleges. They're sexual. Telling them what sex is all about. They're listening. And listen. and there's so many with the same voice, they must be right. I mean, my mother and father, they're just dinosaurs. So would, no, this is just, they're actually listening. And if they're not, listen, if they're not firmly rooted in Christ and the Word, what do they have, guys? And John Piper said, if your vision of Christ is not big enough and not clear enough, you're never going to make it. You know his warfare is out to take every relationship you have, right? You know that, right? You know that families are being estranged from each other in vast numbers? Do you know he's constantly talking to you about other people? What they did to you and what they said, and they had some nerve, and I should have said this when he said that. How come I only think about it now? I should have said it when I was there. Oh, come on. All right, you're all looking at me because you're so spiritual. Your pastor isn't, okay? He's out. And I'm going to tell you what the whole issue is. Today, God needs to help me. Will you please hang in there with me in your spirit? Because I'm telling you, this is the bottom line. You see, when we talk about the fall, I could give you scripture verses, and I should, because I'm just bad. I don't get them together. I try so hard. This time I'm going to get them all together, but I can't. I can't do the things. And you're lucky to get a few of these up there. That's all I'm telling you, okay? I wish I was James, but he's got his slides. How you doing? I got my slides done for next 3 months from now. And I'm like, you got your slides done for 3 months from now? What is that? He's always been strange, guys. Between us. So this is before time. This is the council of the Trinity. Now, how can I get you and I to understand this? The eternal purpose of God, the ultimate. Listen, would it matter to you today if you knew what God was doing? Would it matter to you today if you knew what God's doing? Because the word is very clear, and we are confused as his people. I don't know, and the end times, and I don't understand, and there's good people, this happened. If we would understand his word, it's hidden in full sight. God has always wanted children. He's always wanted a family. He's always wanted a family. And he started, you know, in the garden with Adam and Eve. Well, actually, okay, I'll come back to that. Let's say here he started with Adam and Eve. We know the story. We don't have to go through it again. And you know that they fell, but they didn't just fall into sin. They did fall into sin. And they needed a savior for sin. But that isn't really the primary thing that happened. The primary thing that happened is that they fell from purpose. They fell from God's eternal purpose. Look at Ephesians. Look at Colossians. The eternal purpose of God. That God would have children. He would have a house with children just like Jesus Christ. And God's always wanted a family. The problem is, Adam and Eve were created beings, and we know they fell from purpose. But I don't know that we understand too clearly. Give me that verse, Michael. Before that, I think it is. Before that, yes. We need a revelation of this verse. For the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of Christ Jesus, has set us free from the law of sin and death. Now listen to me. We didn't just fall into sin. We fell into death. there was a law working. There's a law working in every person who's on the face of this earth, who does not have the Spirit of God in them. It tells us clearly in the scriptures that it was the way we walked before we knew the Lord, and we walked in our flesh, and we walked with the nature of the enemy. Now, this is really a hard thing to go around and preach to people that don't know the Lord, but the truth of the matter is, every person that comes into this world is born connected to the God of this world, who is Satan. Are you there? You with me? Do they know it? Did you know it? No. In fact, you thought you were living your independent life. I don't religion, whatever. I know what I feel. I know what my opinions are. And all the while, the problem is, in this realm is sin and death. And everyone who's born is born into sin and death. So you didn't just need to be saved from your sin. You didn't just need to be forgiven of your sin. You needed to be delivered from death. The power of death, what does that mean? That means that you could try to do the things you want to do. It means that there's a law, the law of sin and death. The law of sin and death. It's working in everyone, pulling you, doing things you don't want to do. I'm never doing that again. I made up my mind. No, that I'm not doing that again. And you find yourself doing it again. You see, it's the law of sin and death. Stay with me. You see, that's why the law couldn't save anybody, because it doesn't free you from death. It's just things you do, but it didn't free anybody from death. Does that make sense? You're dead. Therefore, we don't just need forgiveness from our sins. We need life. We need, say it with me, life. I'm going to be talking about that till I go home. The issue is, he that has the Son has the... If you are not his, you do not have the life. Because on Calvary, we learned for so long, he took my sins, thank God. Yes, the very first thing. But he didn't just take my sins. You see, he took it all in himself. He took your sins. Oh, he took you. He took you, your connection to Satan, took it in himself. Paul said, I'm crucified to the world and the world to me. Oh, yeah, that's right. You're set free from the world. He took all that into himself for you. You see, you know that depression and that... Now, okay, we'll talk later, because you're going to say I'm an extreme and you're not going to... We'll talk more. But, you know, your anxiety often, your depression often, your rage often. He took that too in himself. Because what was born of Adam, you've been set free from. And he took it all, and it was in him. Now listen to me. And it went into his body. And therefore, Satan didn't know what he was doing. Because when Jesus died, the whole old creation, Satan's connection to the whole, to the creation, to people, to the animals, he took it all, the whole creation. He took it in himself. That's what started in Gethsemane. That was the cup, saints. and he took it all into himself. And when he died and gave up the spirit, Satan didn't know. But the whole old creation was set free from him too, because we were all in him. When he died, we died, and our connection to the devil died with him. Now, I don't want to be fresh, and I'm not trying to be fresh with you, okay? So please know I love you, but it's going to take more than clapping, because you're going to have to live. I live in this stuff and have lived in this stuff for years. You and I need revelation from the Holy Spirit. You can't just come into a meeting and hear a little bit and then go home and live our normal lives. And then it's not going to happen that way, saints. It's going to cost you. It's going to cost you to decide that you... Listen, the point is this. Oh, Lord, help me to say this. You see, he tried it. He tried it with created beings. He tried it with Lucifer. Well, that didn't go so well, did it? But Lucifer was created, you know. Then he tried it with Adam and Eve, and they were created. So there's only one answer. He decided that if he was going to have love and a relationship with children, he was going to have to live in them and give them his very own nature. Somebody should be jumping up and down. Somebody should be running down the aisle. I don't know. Somebody should be. Do you see? We're not just created human beings. We're his children because we have his life in us. And God's plan and God's, the eternal purpose of God is that we don't have the sin, we don't have the law of sin and death working us and in us anymore. We have the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus that lives in us now. That's why we don't go by the Ten Commandments, because we don't need an outside law. We have an inside law. It's the law of the freedom of Jesus Christ. You know what that means? I don't read the Ten Commandments and say, I have to do this. I really want to do this, but I'll do this because it means that there's another person living in me. You're not here to live your own life. Okay. If you are here living your own life, it's the wrong plan. The Bible is very clear. One died for all, that all died, that we may not live unto ourselves, but unto him. Put your seatbelt on. A lot of times we're in trouble as Christians because we want to live our own lives. We're not really looking, understanding. I don't even want to make us bad because we haven't really had this. We haven't really had revelation. Our leaders don't have revelation. You start getting this and you won't be able to listen to anybody on YouTube. You won't be able to listen to anybody. I listened to a very popular preacher the other day, and he went on and said how happy I should be that I'm myself and that God created me and he created me with my own gifts. And I thought, no, I'm not happy because I was created. I'm happy because I was recreated in Christ Jesus. That's why I'm happy. That isn't the Linda I care about. That's not the Linda I want. That's not the Linda God sees or he wants. He wants nothing. She's dead. He doesn't even know who she is. Trouble is, Satan keeps telling you that that's who you still are. Okay, so just to freak you out completely. So a while ago, the powers we were reading about assailed me one day. And self-pity, discouragement. I felt like, oh, God, it was discouragement. I know, self-pity. I started feeling sorry for myself. And I just, go down the list. I was tempted to be discouraged. And then all of a sudden, saints, because the Holy Spirit lives in you and he talks to you and that law of the Spirit of life, you see, because you don't, and I don't expect that life to talk. We don't expect that. We don't appreciate that life. We don't have revelation that there's really another person that lives inside of you. He really thinks in you. He really has a heart in you. He feels in you. He cares about people in you. There's somebody else living inside your body with you. And so the thought came to me, wait a minute. Is this me? I feel this. Is this me? And I said, wait a minute. This is death. Do you know what death is? The opposite of life. You know what depression is? How many of you have known enough about depression? I have. It's death. Anxiety, dread. Should we go on? Because you have to understand something. You weren't made for this world to satisfy you. So go ahead, go to your fifth wife, your sixth husband, waiting for somebody to do it for you. Oh, it'll happen for a little while. You'll be happy for a little while, but we keep waiting for this world to fill that place inside of us. St. Augustine said, the soul is restless, and until it finds its rest in God, it will never be at rest. So look, so does the enemy have us? Just running around in little circles for the all people. That's what most people's whole life is. You just run around in circles trying to get the, if they'll love me. Oh, I know, if I just could get my finances to get my house. Oh, God, that's great. I love this house. Oh, but I need a new car, I think. This car's not looking good. Oh, I'll get a car. That's what, I'll get a new car. That's great. I know, kids, that's what it is. I'll get my kids, and he'll keep you on that hamster wheel for as long as you let him. Because you see, this is all about your five senses. What you see, what you feel, what you can touch. God, I just wish you would just let me know you love me. I just don't feel like you love me. Linda, take a look at the cross. Don't worry about what you feel. I love you. I proved my love for you, my daughter. But this spirit has senses. You feel your spirit has senses. It tastes and see that the Lord is good. You walk into a house, you sense, I don't know, something's not right in here. Your spirit has senses. You hear. He that has an ear to hear, let him. What ear? This ear? No, not that ear. This ear. Now, see, I don't know where a lot of you are at. I don't know. Like, there's babies in this room. There's people that aren't born again yet, probably in this room. There are people that have, no walk with God, maybe for many years. But the church has to preach this stuff. We've got to preach this. We've got to start making babies. We've got to start. Brand new babies have to understand this. And not spend 40 years in the wilderness. And let's get past this miracle thing, will you? You don't want to go there with me. Hold me back. You don't want to go there with me. I am so tired of the body of Christ running after miracles and not the miracle worker. Or the prophetic ministry that's going to give me a word. I've got news for you. I don't need a prophetic word. I've got the prophet that lives inside of me. Do you know why? Because the body of Christ is living a natural life and we're looking for something. We're living naturally, and the bigger the building, and as long as you go to church meetings, listen, don't come back to church meetings. If you're coming here, you are coming here because we're supposed to be gathering together as the body of Christ, but you're not finding him here. You've got to find him in here, because now I'm going to start landing this plane. You don't understand something. I've just learned. Do you know they were still struggling with the gospel all through the book of Acts? That Peter, at one point, was telling people, you have to repent and be baptized. And then he was, remember the whole eating the meat with the Gentiles? There was confusion. In the book of Acts, they were working out. But I want to tell you what changed everything. What changed everything? I need another poster, Joe. We have to decide what it's going to look like. You know what changed everything? Pentecost. Pentecost was the first time God got to live in a human being. That's what he's been waiting for. The tree of life didn't work out here, right? But Pentecost, when the Spirit was poured out, they became, we get sidetracked with the, I don't have a limit of tongues, and I don't know how I feel about the gifts, really? Because that's all secondary. What's primary is that God came to live in a human beings for the first time. And do you know those people didn't even know it? They didn't even know. They didn't even understand. And that's why God brings this meanest man on the earth, Saul of Tarsus. Now, do you ever ask yourself a question? Here's Jesus schooling all these 12 guys, knows them real well. Why did he go to this guy all the way over here, this mean Pharisee, law-keeping Jew here? I'll probably get in trouble here, but he couldn't. These people would be too confused about Jesus of Nazareth. Because you never hear Paul talk about Jesus' miracles. You never hear him talk about a sermon that Jesus ever gave. Paul got the creme de la creme. On the backside of the desert in Arabia, God gave, and Paul, that's all Paul talks about. And God showed him the mystery that was hidden for the ages, Christ in you, the hope of glory. And that's all Paul talks about. And do you know that three times the Apostle Paul says, my gospel? Do you know God let him use that? Because Paul understood clearer than the other disciples that didn't understand yet clearly. They did come to see it. But Paul's the one who said, I've been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I. I don't live my own life. This is about living from another life. And I want to tell the church something. And the woman I look at in the mirror every morning. It doesn't matter whether you're unsaved, living from your natural life, or you're a Christian living from your natural life. It doesn't please God. He wants the life of his son to be expressed in every one of his kids. Why do you think God put Christ in us? So that he could just be our conscience and let us know how bad we're doing or tell us to try harder? For God is at work in you to will and to do for his good pleasure. He's there to live his. You can't live the Christian life. And it's only a matter of time before you find out. How long is it going to take you to find out you can't do it? You know what living the Christian life is like? If I wasn't in trouble before, you'll protect me, right? You're bigger. Okay. See, living your own life and thinking God's going to make you better, make you more loving, make you all these things, he's going to make you more spiritual. It's exactly what the Antichrist is, trying to be God without God. You see, a trillion years from now, you're going to need Christ as much then as you do right now. He's going to have to be your life. He doesn't say, Michelle, here's life for you. And you hold that. You take care of that, Nancy. Now this, you peace, you keep. You know what he gave you? He gave you one thing. It's all he ever gave you. He'll never give you anything else. And everything you need, he gave you his son. Jesus is your peace. Jesus is your life. The Bible says he's been made unto us wisdom and sanctification. And it's all in a person. And the Church of Jesus Christ today is not understanding. We've left the person. It's like Joseph and Mary when they're on the trip from Jerusalem and they didn't know where Jesus went. It's like that's what the church is. We're busy with a thousand things. Listen to me. Take it, leave it. The charismatic movement got derailed because it was all full of flesh. The faith movement got derailed because it's all full of flesh. And so did the prophetic movement. And I personally am not looking for a big thing out here for God to do. I don't need him to go do a good thing. And we're not waiting for the second coming to live in eternal life. Do we understand that? Amen. And you and I are living right now and we're wasting our days because do you know what the most important thing is for you and I right now, today, in your life, whoever you are, wherever you are? Are you learning to live from the life of Christ? Or are you just living out of your own decisions and wisdom and then asking God to bless you for it, bless you with it? How do I live from the life of Christ? Well, that's what we're doing Wednesdays. That's what we're doing. Learning and waiting on the Holy Spirit. Let me ask you a question. Does your body give you signals? Do you sense? Oh, I think I'm hungry. I think my back hurts. Right? How about your soul? I mean, does your mind, does it tell you things? You have a sense about something, a feeling? What makes you think your spirit isn't talking to you, isn't giving you signals? I don't know, Pastor Linda. I don't feel my spirit. Do you feel your liver? Do you feel your kidneys? What does that have to do with it? The Spirit, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, there's a law in you. He's going to keep you distracted, and he is. He's going to keep you distracted with even Bible study and prayer and make you feel real good about all those things. And I know, I can imagine all the things that are going on in some people's heads, but I'm telling you, there's a whole lot of fleshly prayer, and there's a whole lot of fleshly Bible study, and there's certain people I know that know the Bible backwards and forwards, and I don't want to be in the same room with them. Because renewal of your mind isn't just about replacing thoughts with Scripture. He's the truth. He's the living Word. You've got to know the living Word in the Scripture, in the written Word. And people that just know the Word, the written Word, without the living Word, can be terrorists. His name was Saul of Tarsus. Until he met Christ and found out that there was a nut, that he was living. You don't have to go anywhere for Christ. You don't have to reach out and find God ever. He's there. You know, the Bible says that in him, in Christ, we have been made complete. What does that mean? It means that every human being that is ever born of Adam is not complete. Isn't that a riot? We're born incomplete. Instead of giving love, we're looking for love everywhere. Will you give me love? Will you affirm me? Will you tell me who I am? We're constantly looking and looking and looking. And looking, my kids will do it for me. My ministry will do it for me. What are you looking for? In Christ, you're complete. There's no human being complete without Jesus. That's the key. You're not complete without him. You were made for him. You were made to love him, to know him. Not just to know him out there. You were made to know him right here. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He wants you to know him here. He wants you to know him as your very own life. You need wisdom? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, you're my wisdom. You see, the flesh always has to do something rather than wait on God and believe he's your life. Well, I say all this to say we're meeting again on Wednesday. I don't know how long we'll do it. I don't know how far it'll go. But my passion is this. Whatever time I have left, whatever I have, that's taken me 50 years, honestly, to break the codes of some of this stuff. I mean that sincerely. I hope you don't think I'm bragging about it. I'm telling you, because I'm so dull and thick, it's taken him how many years to try to get through to me? But I'll tell you one thing. It's been my one passion from the day I met Jesus Christ to know him. I never was looking to be in the ministry. Heaven knows I was a woman. I couldn't do that. I'm just supposed to laugh at that. I just wanted to know him because he changed my life. One day in my living room, I saw him with these eyes. And I fell to my knees, and I've never been the same person. Just a little touch of that amazing person we saw on that screen, just a little touch of that amazing Jesus Christ. Just once, that was it. I was 27 years old. My life was never the same. 50 years later, here I am. I'm still wildly in love with him, only I'm more in love with him. So I invite you to come out on Wednesdays. Should we do a song? I guess it's kind of late to do a song. We're going to talk about, on Wednesdays, what we talk about is, how do you touch this life? Romans 6, 7, and 8. I'm dead to the power of sin. One preacher did it this way. He said, how many of you believe every single word in the Bible? Hands. Ask for hands. And then he said, how many of you believe you're dead to sin? Not so many. You know, we're supposed to be living in the power of that. This is the power we have. We have another life that conquered it. We don't resist sin in this life. What a lie. Christians don't resist sin. We're dead to it. Go away. You're a temptation. That's not who I am. That's not who I am. That girl is dead. Now I'm a whole new creation. You better be careful. I'll get my big brother. You better get going right now. I hadn't thought about ending this today. How do I end this? Uh-oh, my husband's got a suggestion. You know, Eve gave Adam the suggestion. I have a feeling Adam's going to give Eve the suggestion right now. He wants me to just tell you this, and then I'm going to close. So, the other day, I had some temptations to negative feelings. Was it? Yeah. It was just not so long ago, last week, and it was again feelings of similar to what I was talking about before. You never stop getting tempted in this life. You know that, right? Nobody. As long as you're here, you're in the world, you're going to get tempted. So the temptations to all those things, anxiety, discouragement. Well, I think I was getting ready for this meeting, actually, honey, wasn't I? And that's what it was. Yeah. I think that's what it was. And I was hit with, negative, like, ugh. And all of a sudden, I had the thought. Why don't you just... That's not you. That's the old. That's the enemy. That's old Adamic. Okay, to say that, I've got to tell you, some of the feelings you have, saints, they come from your old Adamic life. If you can't picture Jesus having the feeling, then you can say no to it. Like, could you picture Jesus sitting on the thing? Man, I don't know. I've just had it with these people. I've tried. Father, I have tried. I am so, and these disciples, they are the dumb. Father, really? This is the best we could do? Peter comes over. Jesus, I've never seen you like this. Listen, Peter, you don't have any idea, okay? Peter, please, just. If you can't picture Jesus having the feeling you're having, then I would tell you that you can say no to it. So all these feelings are attacking me, and I said, or around me, or I'm feeling them, I'm hearing them. You can't figure it out, right? And I said, I had the thought, I had the thought, well, just ignore them. Because I already took my stand in Romans 6:11. Get used to 6:11. I'm dead to sin, alive to God. I'm dead to sin. Make that your foundation every time. Stand on the right ground. Don't stand here and start to fight the devil. Stand here where he's already lost. And just stand there and say, thank you, Lord. I'm free from sin. I just thank you, Father, that the devil has lost his power over me. Stand here. Stand here. Don't go over. Oh, God, please take this away. I've been praying for so long. And this is... Come on, you do too. And then all of a sudden it hit me. You know what? These powers of self-pity and whatever, dread. I said, you're bullies. You know what? You're bullies. And I'm not letting you bully me anymore. Because in the name of Jesus, I am free from your bullying. You know what? You know what? It was gone. I can't explain it to you. Don't ask me to give you it. I'm not going to write a paper about it. You know what I'm saying? Saints, I'm telling you, we're not resisting the world's sin and death. We're not resisting death. We're accepting it. So our relationships are in the toilet bowl, and our self-image is in the toilet bowl. And let's go down the list. Our marriages are in the toilet bowl. Why? We're not resisting the powers of the world of death that are talking to us, and we're listening to them, and then they get ground in us. Does that make sense to you? Gosh, if I could give you anything, please understand that. If you're listening and you're taking it, Satan says, it's yours now. We're not resisting. We're just listening. And we think it's us. And we go on and act out of it. Listen, if that doesn't do anything for you today, seriously, guys, I don't know who you could be or where you could be in your walk that wouldn't be speaking to you. It speaks to me. All the time. I have to get fresh revelation all the time. Oh, that's right. What am I doing again? I'm listening again. Oh, my goodness. You don't just walk into this and suddenly you're going to still be tempted. Well, I'm going to land this plane. Well, Father, we just take everything, the words that have been said, ask you to just, Father, that which is of you, that you will, these seeds will germinate and they will produce fruit. Father, I am asking you for a community here at City on the Hill that knows the new creation realities, that we are really a people that know, that our passion is to know you and to really understand you live in us and to know your life and to cooperate with your life in us. Lord, that's what I pray. I pray for us in this room. I pray for all the brothers and sisters that meet us here. Father, I'm asking you for a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Christ. And Lord, that you might be seen to this world. They've heard enough. They don't care about our words. Let them meet you in us, Lord. Let them meet you. Father, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for your attention.